Okay. So, well, we have very interesting sessions lined up after this. We are having the one for entertainment media, which is writing for entertainment media is not always about entertaining. After that, we'll have one on translating the classics, what not to do. And we also have a very interesting one that is on the crime, why crime thrills. So, of course, not to forget, we have a closing session where our union minister, Mr. Dharmendra Pradhan, will join us. And then there's Ananya Shritam Nanda, the Indian Idol Junior, who will be entertaining us in the evening with the wonderful performances. Post her victory, she is performing for the first time at OLF. So you all can stay hooked to your seats. I think I can already see our speakers coming. All right, ladies and gentlemen, we are ready for our next session. Writing for entertainment media is not always about entertaining. And we have a perfect combination of panelists from the film and theater fraternity with us today for this session. So without any further delay, let me take the privilege to invite them on stage. Mr. Abhishek Chaubey, Mr. Feroz Abbas Khan, and Mr. Sudip Sharma. Let's have a round of applause for all of them. Mr. Abhishek Chaubey is an Indian film director, writer, and screenwriter. He directed the 2010 film Ishq Kiya, which was a departure from the stereotype sweet love story thanks to all the masala it spiced up. He started his career as an associate director and co-writer with a film director, Vishal Bharadwaj, starting with his debut Makri in 2002. He went on to assist him in all his subsequent films. His second film was Der Ishq Kiya, which released on 10 January 2014. Mr. Feroz Abbas Khan is an eminent theatre and film director, playwright and screenwriter. At the forefront of Indian theatre today, he is recognized as much for exploring new forms as for bringing Hindi theatre mainstream recognition. In 2007, he made his film debut with Gandhi, My Father, based on his own previous play, Mahatma vs. Gandhi, which has created a sensation wherever it has been staged and earned rave reviews from national and international media. Mr. Sudip Sharma is a screenwriter of the recent box office and critical hit NH10. He's previously been nominated for Best Screenplay at the New York Indian Film Festival for his Indo-Tibetan indie Same Shuk. His upcoming film is a highly anticipated Urta Punjab, a movie set against the backdrop of the drug crisis in Punjab. I will now request Mr. Feroz Abbas Khan to please take the session forward from here. Thank you.
Good afternoon. Firstly, I would like to thank the organizers, the New Indian Express, for being such a gracious host and inviting us. On behalf of both of them, I would say that thank you very much for calling us, because this is one of the rare times that you have a session about writing and about the craft of writing. Normally you have a lot to do with directors and so on and so forth, but writers hardly, you know, have a conversation and they sort of open themselves up to talking about what they do as writers. And I can understand the problem, because firstly, writing is difficult and complex. We have this wonderful, charming image of Lord Ganesh being a writer, but my experience of a writer is more of a Kumbhkaran. It's more of a guy who really does not want to write. He could be sleeping most of the time, and it's a very difficult job for him. He finds it, you know, he could be doing anything. So you go and meet him about the script that you're writing. He will talk to you about everything but except writing. You find this very, very difficult to write. And again, I can understand, because writing means a lot of suffering. Writing means a good writer gives a lot of himself, because unless he does that, that isn't really writing worth writing. So that's the part about writing. And now you tell a writer to actually now talk about writing, that how does he write? Now that makes it worse for him, because you may call it bombastic, or sometimes you can even say that these are all myths that you created. There are times that a writer writes things that when he looks back and looks at it and he says, did I write this? He is quite himself, quite concerned about the fact that he's written something like this. He doesn't know about it, and it does happen like that. And he has to live the life of characters. He has to go into places internally and externally into the world, which he doesn't want to normally do. It's a lot that it takes. And then he compiles all that, and then he writes that, and then after that he's expected to really talk about writing, that how did he write this and what happened and what is his process. So I quite understand that that is a problem. However, I must say that we have two extremely brave young men here who have really done some extraordinary work, and that they are here today to discuss the craft of what they do. The other part that I would like to clarify is about this whole subject of entertaining, or entertainment is not entertaining. This word entertainment, if we can clarify that, it would help us, because there seems to be a negative connotation with entertainment. It's considered, sometimes that this appeals to the baser instincts. Entertainment means something very silly. Entertainment, you know, is done by people who are sellouts. They are, you know, people who do mainstream kind of work, and so on and so forth. Now that would really complicate, because I think in today's subject and topic, and particularly with the kind of people that we have today with us, I think if we just change that and understand that what we really mean by entertainment is engaging the audience, and keeping that interest alive. Because you must understand one thing, is that the things that we're talking about today is writing for cinema, writing for theater, writing for television, and writing for radio. Now, there is one element that is most important in all this, is the element of time. A theater experience happens for about 2 hours, and if it's something really the most complicated of the lot, because it's ephemeral, it's time-bound, and it's also space-bound. It's a particular day and a time that you come to watch a play, and the play gets over and it evaporates. You can't have it again. So it's a time, appointed time, on which you come and you watch a play. So in that, the writer has to be 2 hours with the audience, all of them together, a combined experience together, and they need to share that. It's a job that he has to be always aware of, that there's a constriction of time and space. Of course, what theater does is that while it constricts the space, it opens up the imagination. Because in theater, it's great, not in terms of realistic representation, but it's very great in its symbolic representation. A stick can be a gun, a chair can be a throne. That's the power of theater. But again, it's time. And that's where the writer knows that he has to do all that within those 2 hours. The same thing with screenplay, that you have about, now you have about 90 minutes to about 2 hours in which you need to tell your story. It could be centuries, it could be decades, it could be hours that you need to do that. Again, it's about time, important. And then, of course, other medium. It's a very exacting art. It's a very exacting craft. In fact, where craft and art ends, we don't know. Many a times, craft is art, as long as writing for theater, television, particularly television and cinema, is concerned. And that's another thing that one has to understand. So, the point is that the writer for this medium, what you call the entertainment medium, is very aware of one thing, that he needs to continuously communicate with his audience, keep the audience engaged for those 2 hours, make sure that, jo hum bolte hain Hindi mein ke tas se mast na ho, he is there engaged, and that's his job. And that's why he is a kind of a writer who has deadlines. He needs to finish all that in time, and to deliver that to the best of his ability. So those are the things I think today, as we go forward, we will be talking about what is writing and how they do it. And there are, you know, various definitions of writing and so on and so forth. And I also tried to figure out what writing is and what screenwriting is or playwriting is. And of course, there is one point that comes, is where does self-indulgence end, and when do a really communication with the audience start, in the sense is that line is a battle line, and that line is also something that many of the people don't get it. They feel that as long as I'm expressing and doing my job or myself, it's fine. It doesn't matter whether the audience gets it or not. But most of the writers know that they need to write about the people who are there watching their work. It's about them. And so there's a very beautiful two lines that Sahir Ludhiani has written, ki kaun rota hai kisi aur ke khatir hai dost, kaun rota hai kisi aur ke khatir hai dost, sabko apni hi kisi baat pe rona aaya. So unless you do that, unless I keep that audience in mind, it's what's happening to them. So the writer's job basically is to explore, his job is to explain, his job is to express the human condition, his job is to reach out to the larger humanity, and as Arthur Miller has very rightly said, it makes all of us less alone. Thank you very much. As I had the job to be the moderator, I would like to now call upon Abhishek to share some of his views and some of his thoughts with us. Abhishek Chaubey.
Namaskar. Thank you for having me here, Indian Express, and thank you for Feroz Khan Sahab. As far as, taking forward with what Feroz Bhai said about entertainment, entertainment, especially in the film industry, has come to mean that this is some sort of a variety show, this is some sort of a burlesque theater, wherein you come in for an experience or for 2.5 hours, we're going to give you a variety show of all kinds of things that are going to happen, some bit of comedy, some bit of drama, some song and dance and all of that, and you go home, and that's what entertainment has come to mean for the audiences at large as well. We are essentially, as writers and filmmakers, we are essentially storytellers, and we provide entertainment via a story, by telling a story. And that somehow has, this is something that has been lost. You know, that doesn't, the audiences don't have that anymore. People don't go to watch stories anymore. And that's a problem as writers we face every day, because when we go out to our producers, we are just, trying to trying to tell a story, but we're not getting the space to do so. So, Sudip and I have a similar kind of a background. We round about the same age and share the same views about cinema. And what we really like about each other and what we get, how we get along and how we work with each other, why there's complete synergy here, is because we understand one thing about writing in movies, that it is essentially about structure, which is what he was talking about, that we have a time. We have about 2 hours, 2.5 hours to tell a story, and that's how audiovisual format in cinema is being viewed as enjoyed. So that's what we've got to do. We've got 2.5 hours to tell this particular story, and we have to find the theme, and we have to make sure the theme comes across in that 2.5 hours. So let me tell you, share a bit about writing Urta Punjab with Sudip. I was in the post-production of my last film, Deedish Kya, and I met Sudip and I told him that, okay, this is what I want to do. All I had was were a few characters, and I wanted to talk about drug abuse and what it does to people, what it does to people who consume drugs, and what it does to people who are in the system where drugs are being smuggled, and be it the police, be it the healthcare system. So I just wanted to talk about drugs and give you an overview of what is happening in the world today. And he heard me out, and he suggested that Punjab might be a very, very good place. Punjab is the best location where we might be able to do this film, because that's exactly what's happening in Punjab right now. And I knew about it, and I read about it. And then we went to Punjab. First, Sudip went there. He was there for about a month, month and a half, and he, what we found there was quite incredible. It was, much more than I had thought. I had some vague idea about what drugs does to people, but what's happening in Punjab kind of sort of blew our mind, because it's incredible. It's a social problem, it's a political problem, and it's something that's affecting about 70 to 80% of the population over there, where you have about 3 out of 4 houses, you know, have a drug addict in them. So when we went there and met those people and interacted with the people over there, interacted with the kids over there, we were kind of nervous. I mean, I remember a day when we went to a police station near Amritsar, about 60 kilometers away from Amritsar, and we went to the police station to meet the police officer to find out what's going on, how the drug trade is carried out here in this remote corner of Punjab. And we actually went to a lockup in that police station, which had children of the age starting from about 15, 16 till about 20, 21, and they were all addicts, and they were there because they were addicts, not because they were criminals. And this was some sort of a de-addiction center, which was actually a lockup in a police station. And we met those children, and we were talking to them, and by the time the third or fourth kid came and started talking to us, I actually couldn't take it anymore. I walked up and left the room, and I came outside the cop station, and Sudip followed me, and we looked into each other, and we said, ki, zimindariyan badh gayi ab. You know, it's not going to be easy from here on, because we cannot do injustice to what we've just seen, because it just shook us up. And this, apart from other experiences that we had, we went to several de-addiction centers, rehab centers, we met healthcare professionals, doctors, for God knows what reason, they are highly accomplished, they are well-educated, they could be making tons of money practicing in Delhi or Bombay or anything of that sort, but they are in this remote corner of Punjab in Tarn Taran, and meeting 400 to 500 patients every day. For what? Just doing it because they want to do this, you know. So when we met these people, we got to know what's going on. We got to learn about the drug trade and how easy it is to smuggle drugs and to distribute drugs across Punjab. We realized we had a huge responsibility in our hands, because whether this film turns out to be a success or not, commercially speaking, we cannot not tell what is going on in Punjab. We have to do that. And nobody has done that. So it becomes our primary responsibility. This has to be the first, you know, piece of entertainment or film or whatever it is that goes out and talks about what's happening in Punjab. And then we come down to Bombay. And then we start writing the film. We are very excited. And we've got a great subject on our hands. We've built some kind of a story. And we start doing structure, and we take several months doing structure. And I think that's the most fun part of screenwriting, by the way, doing the structure. And this happens to be a multiple narrative story where we have 4 characters and their lives, you know, intersecting each other. And it took us several months, about 6 to 8 months, if I'm not mistaken, to get, you know, the basic structure out. And then Sudip started writing. And while writing, the other thing that we had to keep in mind was, I mean, in line with what Feroz Khan Saab said, the 11th commandment, which is very important for filmmakers and story writers, is thou shalt not bore. So no matter how important is what you're trying to say, no matter how important it is, I mean, you're not going to bore the audiences. We were kind of sort of lucky in that, because we had so much plot in the story, because there were so many stories and there was so much going on, that it turned out to be an edge of the seat kind of a film. And but we finished the script and we went out in the market trying to raise finance for it. And that again wasn't very easy. We didn't really tweak the script around to make it more palatable for the producers in the market, because everybody felt it was too dark. We had story sessions and narrations with producers where people would just stand up and walk out in the middle of the narration. But we stuck around until we found our producers and our stars for it. And we were just telling Feroz Khan Abbas Saab upstairs that he said, we are a very great cast in the film. The thing was that when we wrote the film, we thought that no, there are not going to be any takers for this one. And we're going to be making it in a very less budget with no stars. That's the only way we can make this happen. Because we had this illusion that we are trying to say something about the world, and there are no takers. We are doing it for us. We are not doing it for the audiences. And obviously we had no takers. There were nobody coming forward. And the producers who eventually backed me said that if you get stars for the film, then we can look into it. And we started doing that. We went from one star to the other. Lucky for us, we did find. Took several months, but we did manage to get some sort of a cast on board for it, which is how this film happened. But I personally think this is a terribly entertaining film. It is my primary responsibility as a filmmaker and a storyteller to say to tell a story that is entertaining, to provide entertainment via story. I think we kind of sort of, I mean, this is what I believe, but I believe that we managed to do that to a great extent. But that we cannot arrive at that, we cannot provide that entertainment until we, where do we draw stories from? We draw it from the world around us. So until we look around us, what is happening around us, and go and meet those people whose story we want to tell, we're not going to find that, those stories, and then there will be no entertainment. So definitely, as far as the subject goes of today's evening, that it's about entertainment, I definitely think storytelling is all about entertainment, it's about nothing else. However, we need to put into perspective what entertainment actually is. It's not burlesque theater, it's not variety show, it's a story, and a story supposed to move you, make you feel something. And that's what we do. So thank you very much.
Okay, hi everyone. New Indian Express, thank you for having me here. I've been told to speak from over here. No disrespect, really. I kind of prefer that. That would have made me feel too much in the spotlight. Writers hate that. This whole talk of entertainment in the, you know, I mean, so Feroz sir did speak about what exactly entertainment means, you know, and how we look at it. For me, really, it means a story with some sort of a context, you know. If you take a story and strip all context out of it, what you're left with is pure entertainment, you know. That's what we were doing for the longest time. Before a certain kind of cinema came in. That's what Hollywood was doing for a very long time, until the 70s happened and a completely new sort of cinema emerged in Hollywood, with say movies like Taxi Driver, which were actually talking about what was happening in America at that point of time. They were talking about the Vietnam War, you know, Apocalypse Now, all the stuff that was happening at that point of time, and suddenly there's this new distinction which emerged in Hollywood, which was about, are you making movies or are you making films? Movies were really films without a context. You know, movies were the musicals that Hollywood was making all through the 50s and the 60s. Movies and films, on the other hand, was just movies with a context. You know, it was cinema which was not just entertaining, but which went beyond entertaining, you know, which said, okay, I'm going to tell you a story, but I'm going to tell you a story with some sort of relevance to you, with some sort of context to your lives. If you look at what was happening in India, it, around the same time was we saw the emergence of the whole 70s parallel cinema movement, you know, and suddenly there was this school of cinema which had a context, you know, which talked about what was happening to this poor Dalit laborer in a back of beyond village, you know, which was talking about subaltern Indian realities which our cinema was completely ignoring till that point of time. And suddenly we had a cinema with social consciousness. I would say that's it actually went beyond just being relevant, you know. So if we just look at the paradigm, we have cinema without any sort of social context, you know, which is just entertainment cinema. And then you have cinema with some sort of a relevance to us, you know, which is talking about a story which is placed in a particular context, which we kind of try to do in Urta Punjab, you know. If you look at what Abhishek said, is the primary idea of Urta Punjab came from wanting to do a drug-based film, you know, that was how we started. And then we put it in a context and say, okay, you know, if we really want to do a film like this and for it to really hit home, it's important that we place it in a very real context. And that's how Punjab came, and you know, and then the responsibility upon us to do justice to it. If you take it a step further, the third kind of cinema in this paradigm would be, say, a cinema of social consciousness, which actually exists for the sake of giving out that message, you know, which a lot of cinema of the 70s, the parallel cinema movement was, you know, that the story existed out of the context, you know. It was not that, okay, they were taking a story and placing it in a particular context. They were wanting to tell that particular story. It actually went all the way. So this really is the issue. Okay. So say, Ankur, help me out. See, if you take Akrosh,
the old Akrosh,
the original Shyam Benegal's
Nishant
was one. So a lot of the cinema of the 70s, what Govind Nilani did, the stuff that Shyam Benegal did, all of it had a very real context compared to, say, what mainstream Bollywood was doing. You know, even the good Bollywood cinema of the 70s, say Diwar or say Sholay or Trishul, which is very good cinema. You know, it's great entertainment. I mean, I grew up watching those films, loving those films, but it was just pure entertainment. You know, it wasn't trying to convey any particular sort of a social message, and there's nothing wrong with it. You know, it's really what you choose to say as a writer or a filmmaker. You know, it's just your desire to be a particular kind of writer or a particular kind of filmmaker. You know, there is no really right or wrong when it comes to this. I mean, we spoke of some of these films, Trishul, Sholay. Really, we are still watching them. You know, if they come on TV, we still enjoy watching them. And there's this other cinema, you know, which is hugely entertaining. Say, if you look at NH10, I mean, let's talk about personal experience that I had, which was the you know, other film that I did this year. It's, I don't know how many of you have seen it, but if just I have to sum it up in one line, it's a road film gone wrong in Haryana. You take Haryana out of the context, and it's just another slasher movie. You know, it's just another slasher. Nothing wrong with that. You know, Hollywood makes slasher movies all the time. They probably made about 100 of them. But it's not something that personally excites me. You know, if two guys on the run, a couple on the run, and some random goons go after them for a bag of money, and then shit goes wrong. I can see a story there. You know, you can apply the same sort of craft and have a pretty good entertaining story to say over there. But personally, it's not exciting enough. What makes it exciting for someone like me or someone like Navdeep is placing it in a context. Now you say this couple going on a drive, and they run into a bunch of bad guys in Haryana. And why are these guys bad? They're not really bad, but these guys at that point of time are taking their sister away to kill her in a case of honor killing. And suddenly, okay, we're talking, you know, suddenly you have a cinema with a very strong social context. So really for me, those really are the three broad kind of cinema writing, you know, that you can place in the paradigm. Personally, I would prefer to be somewhere in the middle slot. I mean, that's what we've also tried to do with Urta Punjab. So yeah, that's really about it.
Yeah, thank you very much. Firstly, I must say that all our apprehensions that the writers are not very good at talking about that work, I think that should be thrown away, because I think Abhishek spoke very eloquently. I'm not joking. Both were reluctant. Both said, "Ke shuru karte hain conversation, phir baad mein question dete hain." And I can understand, but I think what they spoke gave us a rare insight into the kind of mind and heart that works behind. Now, I'm going to start off, because I think we're going to get into the other aspects of the writing and the kind of work they do. Now, of course, we are slightly handicapped, Shampa, because we have two writers with conscience and social conscience and, you know, political awareness and everything that's right, and they're told everything that is wrong about the cinema. So we know that, but if we had somebody, let's say, hardcore writing Saas Bahu serial every day, have to have a deadline within 2 hours to write, it could have been a slightly different experience to have a conversation with that person. However, having said that, I'm going to start off with some very basic questions of craft. The very basic questions of craft, structure, because both of them, and particularly Abhishek, has said that the structures are very important. So I'm going to start off basically saying that, you know, we have this structure which is called a three-act structure. A three-act structure which has its basically coming from Aristotle. It's been taken in by theater. And then cinema explores that three-act structure. And then you have a structure which with the three-act structure goes what is called the hero's journey. That something happens to the hero and so on and so forth. We'll discuss that in detail. And then, of course, there's another structure that's come in now. And that structure is multiple narratives, multiple stories converging at a particular point, and those are the kind of structures that we have. So I would like to first start off with Abhishek, the most experienced of our writers here, and having done a lot of work and some really significant and interesting and important work, is that how does he, from the journey that he started off, the three-act structure is what is an enduring structure, or how do you start writing? When you have an idea, what is the structure that you take? How does your structure inform your story, or your story is informed the other way around? So I'd like to start off with that.
Sir, in our context, in the Hindi film context, there is another important element to the structure, which is the first half and the second half.
Yeah.
So we tend to make movies with
the
something.
Interval point.
The interval point, yeah. An interval is supposed to be
that's
some...
That's right. We in India have an interval. Yeah. Nowhere else in the world that you have.
Nowhere else in the world, that's unless right. You're making a six-hour film.
That's right.
You have an interval. So it's, it becomes very important because it's very... People say that the cliffhanger moment hona chahiye, interval pe. Everybody comes out to buys their popcorn and they are like, ab kya hoga type. So that becomes a very critical element of our writing. I mean, Hindi film writing, the interval point. We've tried very hard in our writing to keep our interval point ko high mat banao, just keep it going, and you know, yeah. That give them nothing, so that they're going to come back anyway. So, but. How we go about writing our scripts, I mean, I can only talk about my process.
You first.
Yeah. What we tend to do is mostly, more often than not, unless I'm adapting, we've started off with a character. Yeah. What I've had in mind principally is a character. So
just to sort of, you know, it means again we have this whole thing that is it plot driven or it's character driven.
Yes.
So in your case, it's the character that draws the plot thereafter. That his
absolutely.
Journey.
It's been mostly
right.
Like that,
right.
Sir.
So, yeah.
Yeah. So I mean, we have a character, and we have the world that he or she resides in, and the basic conflict that we try and get to. I mean, that's what we're trying to do right now. We're working on another script, and we are struggling at that stage
right now. So sort of, you know, take it there, is that do you start off with something what we call a basic theme, the idea as they call it?
Theme is something that evolves in my head, frankly speaking. I mean, we are somewhere close to it, we are revolving around it, but we don't quite have a handle on it when we are trying to start in writing. What we do know is, okay, there's this guy, and there's something like this his world is. I mean, it might start off with a moment in his life, it might start off with a scene or something of that sort, but we know a few things about this guy.
So, which means your theme is something that you want to actually say.
We want to explore the theme as we go along.
So
with
that
this
becomes
guy.
A point.
Yeah.
That is a reason for you to make the film.
Yes.
The theme becomes a reason.
Theme becomes a reason, then
driven by the character.
Ji.
And then he creates his own world, which is the world of plot that you plot out.
That we plot
and
out.
You
do. This,
Now, in here comes the idea of a hero's journey.
Yes.
Is that something that you are a great sort of, you know, something that you are very attracted to?
Not in a very conscious way, really.
Yeah.
But that's what it ends up becoming, right? Yeah. It becomes very tricky in a film like Kurta Punjab. Like I said, it has four characters. None of them are heroes of any stature. But, you know,
something this is like would be to call to give a people, if you've seen, there are two films of that kind. One is a very famous film called Crash, and then Babel, which had, you know, four different streams.
Yes,
but
yes.
Caught by the same one theme.
Yes, one theme. It is one theme. And Urta especially, I mean, Urta, it talks about, like I said, Urta talks about the drug problem. It talks about, on the one hand, users of the drug and what happens to them, and talks, on the other hand, people who are in the system where drugs are being sold, manufactured, and, you know, so the law enforcement and doctors and all of that. So he talks about all of them. So they are somehow connected.
So they're connected, but
their lives are very different.
Yeah, here it is when you say that when you take a hero's journey or, you know, this three-act structure where you're going with a protagonist and then you suffer or you elate it with what happens to the protagonist, that is one thing. The other is when you have multiple strands, so do you fear that you lose the grip on the narrative? Though your film may become much more dense and far more layered, but in the layering you might lose the audience because it says, well, I'm invested in one character, now you've gone around jumping on other characters. How do you negotiate that?
I think a certain amount of skill.
So,
you know, it's definitely very tricky when you say that, because, you know, what happens is it's hard enough to understand a human being in 2.5 hours of space, and you now you're trying to tell me about four and their life, and I'm supposed to get into who are they like, what they feel like, what the problem is, what they want, and like everything I've got to make it understand. And if I divide 2 hours into four characters, there's very little time, you know, on each character. So, yes, I do agree. So what, it should not become a highlights package of the character's life.
Yeah,
either.
It shouldn't become set pieces.
Exactly.
And it must have the whole graph of having reached a climax as you go around. Sudip, you know, you have written NH10. And you've been talking about the fact is that, you know, it must have a social context and so on and so forth. Of course, you can come in with the idea of, you know, the three-act structure and so on and so forth. But tell me one thing. For you, is the context the driving force? Or you got a film and you say, can I find a context to my film? Can I make it socially context? You know, because I feel this film just on its own is a stash of film. Or is it somewhere down the line you are somebody who believes that as writers of cinema, you are also chronicler of times? Is that, are you the people who believe that, look, what happens around me must be chronicled in my cinema? You are a chronicler of time. I mean, everybody does it, but somehow we feel that the cinema people stay away from there. They would rather have something that is the escapism or the fantasy of that time, and not rather the concerns and the joys of that particular time. So how do you really negotiate that?
Actually, it's a very difficult sort of a negotiation. I mean, you have to do it on a sort of a day-to-day basis, because there are only so many stories that you can tell in your lifetime in a year, and there are some pressing concerns. So there are things happening around you which are bothering you.
Like to specifically about NH10, is that you already had a story, you already had a form, and you say, can I now put it among the Khap Panchayat?
No.
Do the Khap Panchayat become something just to contextualize, or it's something that you both and all of you strongly believed that this needs to be brought out there?
If you really don't believe in it, the fakeness is going to show through. You know, you have to feel for it. You know, you have to, and the only way to really feel for it is by getting in there, you know, by doing your research, by getting to know more about it, by meeting those people, and just understanding the world which you are trying to create. I mean, we sort of live ridiculous lives in Bombay. You know, it's a very sheltered, it's a very cocoon sort of a life. Most of us film people are meeting only film people. We're just feeding off each other. Very incestuous. And we're just feeding off each other. And
so it becomes a kind of a...
So it's important to, you know, to pluck yourself out of that context and say, okay, I'm gonna place myself in another world and I'm going to figure that world out and then be able to do justice to it for the big screen, you know.
Yeah. So I think here the question would be is that you contextualize your work, is it a career move? Or you do it in the sense that what happens that when you see a subject like Urta Punjab, and when you get so involved in it, somewhere down the line, does an activism idea come into you and you say, look, you know,
I really want to get out there and more people. So this whole idea of a filmmaker, where does he draw the line between an activist and a guy who makes to make a compelling drama? I mean, does that something that you
In the real life, if there is any moment when you feel like an activist, you just go meet your financier or producer. I mean, you stop feeling like one right away. But to be honest with you, we are essentially storytellers, right? I mean, even the wildest of fantasies are really drawing out from your own world that you see around
right.
you.
Right.
So, where are we going to get our stories from? We're not. We've realized that, like Sudip said, we're not going to get it between Juhu and Malad. It's not going to happen. We've got to go step out and look around and what's happening in the world today and get stories from there. And Urta or NH10 for that matter are stories of that kind where we come. It's not that he knows Haryana very well or I know Punjab. I'm not even from Punjab. But we look around. We go out and seek stories and we find them. We find the themes. I did not have a theme of Urta to begin with. Right. It was just a drug film, you know, and it's just a fascination with the drugs, the drug film. And
no, but as you go along, does the work that you do start affecting you? Because it starts interfering in your life,
definitely
or start
does, yes.
actually informing your life.
Is yes. that,
you know,
yeah,
and you ask a question, is my work worth it? I mean, is this life what people are living, and am I going to be able to do something?
Right. So I make.
Yeah, you do have, but you do have to keep a check on yourself when that happens.
Exactly.
Because we shouldn't take ourselves that seriously, as screenwriters and filmmakers, because we are not really changing the world. We are not going to change the world. We sort of come to peace with.
But then if you don't feel that the world can change,
then
why you make these kind of films and why not then continue to make only escapist cinema?
No, we can talk about it. We can just bring it out in the open. I think the problem comes when it just becomes too heavy-handed. Once we start thinking that, hang on, I'm going to solve the Punjab drug crisis by making this problem, I think it's a...
No, it's not a solution. What I'm talking about is that you as a person start having a life beyond the film. It means that after the film is over, you are engaging yourself in the issues of drug prevention.
Yeah.
Your voice then goes just beyond the film and that you keep fighting for it or you keep sort of, you know, do you put that as something that you would do after you finished a film like Urta Punjab?
I believe talking about a particular problem, talking about the world is changing it.
Yeah.
That's the sum of what we do. Yeah. I mean, you know, we don't do any more than that. And when Urta goes out there, if it's a film worth seeing, if it's worth anybody's time, if people watch it, I'm not going to pick up cudgels and go out and do any dharna in Punjab. That's not what I'm going to do, you know, after it. So my activism, if there is any, it ends with the film.
Okay. All right. I think that's a fair. I think we are going to be very disciplined on our time. We are not going to go beyond the mandate. But what I'm going to do now is I think I see so many eager faces here wanting to ask questions. And I think that's really very important for all of us in terms of the work that we do. So we would now leave it open. It's going to be now a two-way conversation. You could be asking us questions. And to the best of our ability, we'll try and answer those questions. So the floor is open now. Yes.
This is primarily to Sudip, but could be others could respond also.
Microphone closer.
Yeah.
The craft of asking a question is to get the microphone close to the mouth.
Yeah. This is a very popular misconception that a lot of people have, and I've seen it everywhere, about the difference between serious cinema and popular cinema. You know, when people talk about it, and the same difference doesn't come when you talk about serious literature versus popular literature, that people often think that serious cinema means it has to have a social message. You know, you don't say that serious literature has to have a social message.
Yeah.
And I seem, you know, when you were speaking, Sudip, though I strongly am for films with a social message, but it, you know, you seem to be making that distinction. Could you please clarify your position on that?
I mean, even with literature, it has started happening. We, in India, we really didn't have popular literature for the longest time. you know, at least in English, you know. In the last 5 to 10 years, we have had, you know, a bunch of new writers coming up, and a bunch of, you know, stuff happening in popular literature. So I think people have started talking about that. But yeah, I mean, social message was what I meant by the third paradigm, you know, that, okay, there is a entertaining cinema, then there's cinema with a social context. Third one, probably, you know, which is a little on the extreme side, is cinema with a social message that, you know, at the end of it says, don't do drugs. I mean, probably Chaubey and I would not want to go there, you know. You put it out there and say, okay, now make a choice, now make an informed choice, but this is what it is about. So social message per se doesn't excite me.
Another question?
Yeah, hi. I wanted to know here, can you make an entertaining film or an entertaining cinema, some kind of an entertainment cinema, without having romance?
Can you come back again? We didn't hear properly.
So I'm saying, is it possible to make an entertaining film without romance? I mean, I can see a play, Mahatma versus Mahatma, but can I have something of that sort without romance, without a hero and a heroine? And I mean, I have nothing against it, but let's say, for example, Vishal Bharadwaj's Heather. I mean, there is an undercurrent of, you know, attraction and romance. Well, not really.
He was doing Shakespeare.
Yeah, but then otherwise, is it possible?
I think I get your question. Is that, can there be a very entertaining film without romance? I think it's a very, to me, honestly, yes, of course. Why not? You could have.
Yeah, so could you give me examples?
There is no, see, romance is ras. It's a ras, okay? So it's something which is rather easy, and everybody, see what happens in cinema, you must understand, is that all those things which is missing in people's lives are expressed in cinema. Okay? So by and large, they have worked out that romantic lives of most of the people are rather extremely boring. Because what happens is that period of romance that ends in many places, one of the problems that people have is that period is very short. Okay? And as you get very familiar with people, you keep talking about the times that you had. Like, for example, you meet and talk about the great time I had my first, you know, my first crush and my first so on and so forth. You know, that time of your college, that time of your school. So I suppose there is something about it that is very attractive. So I suppose people use romance for that. To believe that there cannot be any film which is just that, there have been many films like that. In fact, if you see some of the old Johar and Mehmood films, there hardly had any romance. But they had great fun there, okay? So I suppose, yes, to your question, there can be and people are making it. But because there's so much of less of romance in people's lives, people are making romantic films.
Yeah. My name is Vikas. My question is to Abhishek. Which point in time in your mind you decide on which theme you will write and make a movie? While you are doing Udte Punjab, maybe there would be parallel so many themes running through your mind. So whether it is creative or commercial decision to make write and make a film?
Very good question.
Thank you for the question. I think the decision is creative, thankfully. I mean, when you're still trying to think of the film, by that time the money bags have not walked into your life. So you're still fine. You can make that call on your own. And how do you decide that is principally if you come up, if there is an idea in your head, if there is something in your head and it lingers on rather than just dissipate after a few days, if it just stays with you, and then you do some confidence building measures like sharing it with Sudip and he shows some excitement, and there you go, and you take it from there.
Yeah.
Sir, I have a question now. Actually, our Bollywood is ruling over about 60 years from in India, but how come, like you are saying that we are motivating our audience by giving strong social messages. But how come we can't bag Oscars in the festivals like that?
How come we don't win Oscars?
Yes, sir.
Why is it important to
win? Why are we lacking band? What are the causes that we're lacking band to bag an Oscars?
Pardon, can you come back with the question?
Actually, means in Bollywood, we are giving strong messages like Tare Jameen Par, like we're giving strong messages to the society.
Yeah.
But what are the things that are, what are the drawbacks of the Bollywood films that can't bag Oscars?
First of all, why should we only aspiring for Oscars? Is somebody else defining, you know, who you are and what kind of work you do? I think we need to get out of that mindset, as long as I'm concerned. I mean, who, you know, are we still going to be defined? Like, for example, there are so many realities of India which the Oscars don't understand. For example, tie and talk to somebody in Oscars, do you mean what is Mahadalit? He would be flummoxed. He will not understand what Mahadalit is. He just will say, what do you mean by that? There are so many things that we are, and I think, because this is where the problem is. Imagine, a film is made in 50 lakhs, and then there are people trying to collect 10 crores to do the marketing and promotion of their film, which money is going to go to some PR publicist in the United States of America, and then you are nowhere in the race of the film. This whole idea that we are going to be defined by other people or by an Oscar or by Cannes, I think we need to get out of that. As Abhishek said, it has to be a film that touches him, is a film that stays with him, is a film that something he wants to say. And let me tell you one thing, and I have gone through that process, in which sometimes there's a film that becomes poisonous in your body unless I get it out of the system. But I just cannot live. So I suppose when you come to that point, and that's where you create something very special, so I suppose that's the way it should be, and you forget about this Oscar business.
And keep in mind that no American film has won a Filmfare Award till date.
Yes.
Hello.
Can I?
Good evening. Hello.
Yeah, sure.
Good evening.
Okay. Good evening.
My question is to Abhishek, Mr. Abhishek. And you said that you have implemented a structure in your films, movies. So what sort of structure? Is it a story within a story, or a story having several stories that, many stories that is contest?
I mean, I understand your question. Like Feroz Bhai had said when he was talking, that playwrights and screenwriters are bound by time. Whatever we want to say, whatever story we want to say, we only have those 2 hours to 2 hours, 2.5 hours to say it. So that, the theme, the story, the journey of the characters have to be, you know, told in that 150 minutes at the most. Okay. So if you only have a certain amount of time to tell a story, it is very important, the structure has to be very correct, you know, because, I mean, there are many formulas to it. Tomes have been written about it, about what structure should be. First plot point should occur in page 25, within the first 20 minutes of the film, where the hero discovers a problem. Then second plot point, where the hero encounters the biggest issue and everything, all is lost. And then the second coming of the hero, where he wins it all. I mean, tomes have been written about it. Without getting into detail about it, just remember this, that there is only so much time to tell this story, and therefore what needs to happen when, which is essentially what structure is, becomes very important.
Is it the image?
I would like to keep the discipline of time here. We have very little time. I think we'll take just two more questions, and because there's another session, we're already late with that. So if there are just two more questions, and then we can pretty much wrap up our conversation today. Just two questions?
Abhishek, the gentleman, the lady. First of all, congratulations on picking up this topic which you have taken up for Punjab.
Hello.
Secondly, I just wanted to know that during this work which you have done, did you reach up to a particular stretch where you could, where you have come across, or where you could reach a position or a point in your film or in this particular story where now it has become very difficult in Punjab? Girls refusing or parents refusing boys, that whole gender issue which was there of differentiation between the boys and girls of Punjab mein itna tha. But due to this particular problem, now families are refusing their daughters into marriage to even to well-to-do families because of this particular issue. It's not a basically a question, but did you could reach to that level in your research?
To be honest with you, when we did go to Punjab and we spent several months there before we started writing, it's an iceberg, and in film we can only barely touch the tip, to be very honest with you. So that's what we managed to do. we have, this is the first film about this problem, and we can, I can guarantee we can make 10, and we would still not have covered the entire length and breadth of the problem. But we did manage to talk about it in general, about what is really happening in there, in Punjab. Yeah.
Just one more question, please.
Sir, yeah, my question goes to you like this. We all know that imagination has no limits. Whereas cinema provides only 2.5 hours like this to tell the entire story. So is it very difficult for a writer to express those ideas in a 2.5 hour, or maybe his ideas are not properly incorporated in the movie? So what are your opinions regarding this?
I think, again, you're talking about the subject that we talked about, time. Now, 2.5 hours is also becoming a luxury. It will not be 2.5 hours. It's getting less. It's getting to be somewhere around, 110 minutes or maybe maximum 2 hours. It's going to be somewhere around that. That's the challenge, and I think that's the nightmare and the beauty of this medium, is that how you condense it. How do you condense the whole thing within that period of time? And that's where structures are very important. Clarity about your theme, the depth of the character. To me, I'm not one of those guys who believe is that verbosity means depth. I mean, I'm not one of those guys. You can say some beautiful things in just a couple of lines, and that's where it is. And I think that's why Shakespeare was a great poet and also a playwright, because I think it needs to be a poet to understand how do you condense experience, how do you condense emotion and thought just at the same time, beautifully said, and yet have a great impact. And that's why I would say poets have a better chance, and some of our great playwrights have been great poets. You need to do that, and that's the way it is. Thank you very much, and I think
excuse me, sir. Only one question.
Pardon?
Only last question, please.
One more question.
Yeah.
Sure.
I just wanted to pay you thanks that you told that the Oscar people have not got a Filmfare Award. So I was just thinking that actually I am very thankful to you. Rabindranath Tagore got the Nobel, but he has not got Odisha Sahitya Academy Award. That is why I was very happy to listen that. But my question was that why we are talking about Hollywood? What about the Iranian pictures like Majid Majidi or Kiarostami's pictures? Never people talk, never I have heard any time Bollywood people talking. Without so simple pictures, and they have made impact, so much impact about the Kiarostami, Kim Ki Duk, and this Majidi. Why is it the dearth of any...
No, we talk about it all the time. In fact, film people are obsessed. They only talk about other people's films. And Iranian cinema, Korean cinema, Japanese cinema, yes. Hong Kong cinema, Mexican cinema, all sorts of cinema is discussed at every coffee shop, in every table, in Bombay. So it's not that people are talking about it.
And also, let me tell you that even in India, we are making such extraordinary films. We seem to be getting into a bit of a myopia talking about, Hindi cinema. Hindi cinema, today we didn't have much time, because I would have tried to explore the idea of language in the Hindi cinema, because that itself has got problems. So, but if you see Bengali cinema, you see, all our regional language, they are creating extraordinary work. In fact, the question has to be asked is that why is it? Like, for example, even now, when there is a national award, everywhere on the newspaper front line, you will see the award that has been given to a Bollywood film. Now, most of the time, the so-called Bollywood, mainstream cinema, the award is given as the most entertaining film. However, the best film could be a Malayalam film, could be a Bengali film. Marathi film today. Marathi cinema is just outstanding, the kind of work that they're doing, matching as good as what the Iranian cinema or some of the other countries are making. So let me tell you that our regional cinema is very, very rich. Hindi cinema is not Indian cinema only. Okay, let's be very clear on that. Thank you very much.
One more question, sir. Excuse me?
Yeah.
No, I think we will have to end this session. You can take the question off the dais.
Okay.
Thank you. Yeah. All right. Okay, sorry. Okay, fine. Well, thank you. That was, I think, a pretty interesting session that happened. May I now request the editorial director of the New Indian Express, Mr. Prabhu Chawla, to please present mementos to our esteemed panelists. So writing for entertainment media is definitely not always about entertaining. Yes. It's much more, in fact. Thank you, gentlemen.